We're adding Indian English pronunciations to the OED. This is a short discussion about what we've done and the journey we've taken to get here. I'm Matthew Moreland. I'm the Senior Consultant Phonetics Editor for the OED, and I've been responsible for drafting the World English Pronunciation Models since 2015. With me are...
Divyanshi Shaktawat. I'm a final year PhD student at the University of Glasgow, and I acted as a phonetic consultant on this model.
And I'm Catherine Sangster. I'm the executive editor for pronunciations for Oxford Languages and head of pronunciations for the Oxford English Dictionary.
Now, Catherine, as you know, I deal with a lot of the detail of these models, but my work only kicks in once the need has been established. So why did OED decide that we needed Indian English pronunciations?
So OED covers World Englishes, has covered World Englishes for many years in its descriptions, in its definitions. And since 2016, we've covered as much of the English speaking world as possible in our transcriptions and our audio, so in our pronunciations as well. Indian English is not the first World English variety we added. So in 2016, we added a set of new World English pronunciations, but it's definitely been one that we've been very keen to add for a long time, and it's really exciting that we're finally there. Having pronunciations in the dictionary is a way for us to allow users to listen to the words spoken as well as seeing them transcribed, and which can be more accessible, and it's a good way for us to illustrate the reality of how kind of variation there is. It's always quite challenging to come up with a model for any World English when you've got social diversity, geographic diversity, and speech communities in different places. And you know, never more true than with this variety. And as with all of our World English models, this one is intended to reflect the most common features that are spoken by the majority of educated speakers of that variety as we define it. So it's taken longer to come up with a model for Indian English pronunciations than for some of our other World English models. Once we had decided we wanted it, we found it was a far more complex situation than some of the other models that we've developed. Matthew, you had some of those early discussions with our consultants. What came up?
So I met with two consultants, Rohini Bakshi and Dr. Meg Campbell, who helped me make sense of the context I've been reading about for Indian English and the interplay of historical and demographic and educational and geographical factors resulted in a far more complex picture than we were looking at for, say, Scottish English or Australian English. Divyanshi, would you agree with that?
Oh, certainly. The biggest challenge to studying Indian English is the fact that it is a product of transfer from the several regional languages that are spoken across India, which in turn belong to multiple language families. So based on the languages spoken in a region, you will hear a slightly different accent of Indian English. On top of that, Indians are usually trilingual, and thus they may speak multiple Indian languages. This in turn may add much variation within their accent of English. Also, this is something that is not aided by the comparative deficit in research on Indian English. So after this, when you add the historical, demographic, and educational layer to it, it indeed paints a very complex picture.
So there was just about enough consistency if we were very specific about whose pronunciations we were giving, as you've said, Catherine, for us to generate an evidence-based model for Indian English when the words originated outside India, like kit, trap, north, words like that. But these aren't the sorts of words for which OED would routinely give an Indian English pronunciation. We do this for words which are particularly associated with India or with Indian English. And only some of those, such as post-graduation or presidentship, aren't borrowings from other languages spoken in India. So what became very clear from our consultants was how, when a word is borrowed from, say, Bengali with Almira or Marathi with Vada, an Indian English speaker's familiarity with that root language could make a very big difference to their pronunciation. So if they're very familiar with that language, they might code switch, which in this context is where a speaker fluently moves between languages or between varieties. and the variability and the way in which this is done seem to be different from how this works with the other varieties of English we've covered. And this is a concern because of our broader approach to naturalization and code switching in the OED. Catherine, could you explain a bit about that?
So put very simply, the concern about code switching is that the Oxford English Dictionary is a dictionary of English, and we have to kind of negotiate that territory where somebody who speaks another language is nevertheless saying the word that is borrowed into English from that language in English, and when they are fully switching in terms of their phonology and their intonation and everything into speaking that other language for the duration of a word or a phrase or a sentence. And so we cannot start to give fully elaborated pronunciations for all of the different languages from which English borrows its words. So that's really where it comes down to. Naturalization is the process by which a loan word becomes more like English. And what we tend to see in OED with all sorts of loan words, think about, you know, words for food terms from all sorts of languages or cultural artifacts or many different areas in terms of the lexicon. You often get a kind of a continuum from a pronunciation which is very anglicized to a pronunciation that is something in the middle, to a pronunciation that is very close or as close as can be possible within the phonology of English to the language from which English has borrowed the word. There's a great discussion about naturalization, specifically in the context of this Indian English edition, in the blog post that Matthew has written, which I encourage anybody who's interested in finding out more about naturalization to take a look at. And the link to that should be on your screen now. So let's think about what our Indian English model actually looks like. For the reasons we've just discussed, we don't want to give a fully Hindi or pronunciation, but you came up with a way to allow the pronunciations to be much more influenced by the root languages than we've been able to do before. And the result is a core model plus what we call ELSI, our extension for languages spoken in India. Can you tell us a bit more, Matthew, about how that all works?
That's right, Catherine. So like any other pronunciation model, we have a set of vowels and consonants and the patterns in which they occur. And that's derived from some fantastic academic descriptions of Indian English by academics such as Gargesh, Celia, Wiltshire, and Divyanshi's help has been invaluable in helping us resolve some of the discrepancies or areas with less clarity. But we also have ELSI. Now, ELSI is a special table that essentially allows us to bend pronunciations towards the root languages where that's warranted. And really, ELSI has two parts. ELSI has the public-facing bit, where essentially you might notice a symbol from outside of the standard model, like the Q that comes in for a voiceless uvular plosive sound in words, some words of Urdu origin. And then there's an evolving rubric behind the scenes that editors can use to get from perhaps the Devanagari or a recognized transliterated form of a word into the OED pronunciation model that is then dependent on the root. So for example, an E letter might become a short or long E sound. A ZH as a sequence will usually become a J sound, but in some Urdu words might become J. So various sources are helping us with that evolution, not least Divyanshi's input on our first batch of words to receive these Indian English pronunciations. Now, of course, we always come back to evidence. That's always our starting point, is these evidence of words being used in natural language use. We are descriptivists, so even if the model would predict something that speakers just don't do, then we go with what speakers actually say rather than what the model might predict. But Divyanshi, I mentioned your invaluable input here. How did you decide what to recommend to us in terms of some of the discrepancies between the literature and in terms of the individual pronunciations?
So at the beginning, what helped with this model was the fact that it is guided by the LC, and it is focused on educated speakers, which dictates that we're looking at a certain subset of the wider population. So that filtered out quite some variation. Then I started my work with examining existing research, and based on that, it became clear very quickly that for some variables, there wasn't much variation, for example, just consonants in general, whereas for some others, it was much more complicated, for example, vowels in general. For consonants in the transcriptions, I noticed some inconsistency in the suggested choice of retroflex and dental stops and what speakers actually use, especially in Indian root words. Making suggestions for that was pretty straightforward, as there isn't much individual variation in that. For vowels, however, there was much more variation in the choice of variants. For example, the trap bath distinction in Indian English is still quite murky. So then in such cases, I turned to the speech data that I had collected for my PhD and also especially for this work. And I realized that in some cases, multiple variants were actually valid and more inclusive of the speakers that we're looking at. So in wanting to be fair to them and being more authentic, in such cases, wherever appropriate, I offered information on these multiple variants or information on a certain feature that was dominant in a certain regional accent. So ultimately, my suggestions and feedback were rooted in what speakers were doing.
Thanks, Divyanshi. So once our pronunciation team had our transcriptions all prepared, just like with any variety of English, we then line up speakers to come and record for us. So, Catherine, can you tell us a bit about how that worked?
Yes, so we develop a model while our lexicographer colleagues decide exactly which words they want to cover. And often we'll look at both new additions that might be happening around other work on a particular variety, and also we'll go back and look at existing entries that have words that match that particular world English as well. So once that's in place, the transcriptions are all made, and then when we have a list of transcriptions, what we want is to create the audio that goes along with them. So when you look in an OED entry, you'll see the transcriptions written down and you'll be able to hear audio. And our audio is not synthesized, it's real live native speakers of the correct variety speaking it out loud. So we prepare recording lists, we have a recording facility in our Oxford office, and our speaker comes in, works with a sound engineer and an editor to create the audio that is then chopped up and connected to each of the dictionary entries. So I thought, although you'd be able to listen to these things on the OED website itself, you might like to listen to a few of them now. So here are some examples of the new words that we've added for the Indian English pronunciations.
Yaksha, Diya, Vada, Pallavi, Bindas, Amrit.
This last example is picks up on what Divyanshi was just saying about variants, where we have in many cases we give more than one possible pronunciation and audio to go with it. So there are three pieces of audio for this word.
Almira, Almira, Almari.
So the extension for languages spoken in India, LC, I think it's important to reassure that introducing LC doesn't mean kind of anything goes, does it? It's not going to change what we've done with our other varieties.
Absolutely not. So if you're familiar with Asimov's three laws of robotics, all of our models have to abide by our own three laws of pronunciation lexicography. Each of our pronunciation models must first and foremost be meaningful. So it has to capture the salient sound contrasts and qualities of the variety. They must be faithful. So they must be faithful to the published academic literature on that variety, but they also have to be usable. And it needs, therefore, an internal consistency, a predictability, a simplicity that means that dictionary users can become familiar with it and use it practically. Now, kind of in reverse of Asimov's laws, it's the third of our laws, if you like, that limits the other two. If displaying a particular subtle contrast or adopting a specific detail from a research paper would render the model too complicated, then we don't include it. So ELSI doesn't change that. We're only representing salient details from the academic literature that make sense for us to do so. And everything is still couched in English terms, just as with our other varieties. So it's perhaps not as radical as it might seem at first. We aren't giving a Bengali or Hindi pronunciation, but we are giving a very minimally anglicized form. And that code switching and naturalization do seem to be regarded in Indian English differently compared to most other varieties that we've covered. ELSI is essentially just one step further down the road than what we've done for the Maori loans in New Zealand English, and a couple of steps further down the road than what we've done with Afrikaans loans in South African English. Now, there might come a day when we have other extensions tables like ELSI for other varieties of English, but there just isn't the same complexity at the moment to warrant it for any other varieties now.
Thank you. And I'd just like to conclude by saying I hope this has been a little insight into how we've worked on the Indian English pronunciations and how we work on World English varieties in general. I'd like to wrap up by saying thank you to you, Divyanshi, for your consultancy here, to our other consultants as well, and to the academic researchers whose published work has informed our work on this model. I'd like to also say thank you to you, Matthew, and to our colleagues in Oxford Languages who help with processes like making the recording lists, doing the sound engineering for the sessions. Of course, our speaker herself and everybody who's collaborated to allow us to be able to get these Indian English pronunciations available in the OED in both transcription and audio form. Thanks. If you have any more questions, please do get in touch with us. And you can have a look at the blog post that I mentioned earlier, and you can read all the details of the model, see a key, and of course, look at the actual words that have now got audio accompanying them by following the links that you can see on the screen now. Thanks.